So the topic here, I cover the damped and forced oscillations affecting gauge measurements on materials and devices. That's a very nice stage. So we start here as an outline. The outline of my talk is going to be covered in these following sections, like introduction, damped oscillations, post oscillations, and then we demonstrate the pulse pendulum. And then I give a real example of the material, like a dielectric material that once we apply and a dynamically varying electric field across a material, then how it is going to behave. So I'm going to cover it. So this is what we see in nature. Nature's gift is basically oscillation, its own way of finding equilibrium. We see it at, I mean, you just think about a situation and you will find an oscillation there. The way we are inhaling, exhaling, all this is an oscillation, is going at a particular frequency. So this is all we readily observe in the nature. And the pioneers who basically built this concept, the credit goes to these two guys, Huygens and Robert Wishart Paul. I mean, it's really amazing to think about their line of thinking, the way they were doing it. And this fellow Huygens is also so called as founder of mathematical physics. So, physics and mathematics go hand in hand with each other. So whenever we start doing some physics, mathematics has to assist us. And basically many a time this is happening when we do a rigorous mathematics, a new concept emerges and we appreciate the way it has come up. So for solving this problem of oscillations, what is the motivation, from where we start? We start with the Hooke's law, the restoring force, that has already been taught enough number of times while at schools. We write a Newton's second law in the form of a second order differential equation now. So this is how we start with. Once we have a ready situation, means we expect the medium to be free from any material particles. So then this is the equation, the first one that we show here is the Newton's second law for the restoring force only. Then we come and realize that this is not the practical condition all the time. We have basically everything, every medium available around us as a damping medium. So all these oscillations are going to die out soon. So the factor that is affecting these oscillations to die out is nothing but the damping offered by the medium. So this damping is also sometimes referred as resistive forces. So we have these range of resistive forces working on the low frequencies, low velocities, as well as the high velocity range. So most of the time we encounter the low velocity part, but the high velocity part is also there. So then we have this, some adjustment of the terms is there, the way we start solving this second order linear homogeneous differential equations. And most of the time, the popular technique, what is used to solve these differential equation is providing a solution by inspection. So this is what we provide as a solution for the inspection. And then the roots, what we get here are going to help us for getting the general solution that has been shown here. The general solution is showing an interesting term that is basically under root of gamma square minus omega under square is nothing but the frequency only. So what is happening, this gamma is a new term that is basically including the damping characteristics of a medium and is nothing but the function of damping coefficient. If you see here, this gamma is nothing but B by 2M. So if we just look at this general solution, we can realize that it's a basically interplay between the damping affected new frequency and the natural frequency of oscillation. So that's a very nice interplay, very interesting interplay, I would say. And this interesting interplay lead us to think into categories of damping. Can damping be over effective, or can damping be under effective, or can damping basically equate the natural frequencies? All these three possibilities we discuss here, like heavy damping, weak damping, and critical damping. So these three are very interesting cases, and this is actually the real life. Heavy damping means whenever this damping is so much effective, so that it is difficult to record the natural frequency of oscillation. So that's a case of a heavy damping. Here basically oscillation has to die out very soon. So this is what we see here. And once we talk about this dying out soon, means what is happening basically, that I'm going to show that shortly, that the relaxation time, the moment, the time within which the oscillation has to come to a rest will keep decreasing, and also the frequency will keep reducing. I'll show that. And then the weak damping is here, of course, the case where this natural oscillation is effective and is dominant over the damping caused by the medium. So this is the situation. What is happening? I mean, whenever this damping is coming into picture, we can very well say that the motion can keep remain oscillatory, but the periodicity will be lost, because this damping will arrange this oscillation to die out soon. So die out soon means that will not happen. That, I mean, particle is not expected to basically obtain its initial position again. So means at one particular point of time, if its position is A prime, the second time it is going to be decreased again, and that will be A double prime. So we say that it remains as oscillatory in nature, but the periodicity is lost. So that's the nature of damping. Damping will arrange this oscillation die out soon, and in this process, periodicity is lost. Then this critical damping, when these two effects are almost comparable to each other, we see that this is going to again arrange a very nice general solution given to us in the form of two dependences. One is a linear dependence, another one is exponential decay as well. So that is what we are going to study in the form of the velocity. So when do we expect this velocity has to be the maximum? What is the time there? And then what about this relaxation time, when we can have this interplay? That the relaxation, I mean, there is a struggle between, there is a struggle for an oscillator to keep maintaining its natural frequency of oscillation against damping. So that gives us a particular relaxation time that is basically given here 1 by gamma. So after that time, it has to follow the medium. I mean, till that it can keep resisting and keep on the track to maintain its amplitude, but the moment will come when this damping will dominate and the oscillation has to die, has to start damping. So this is the truth, that all real oscillating units undergo weak damping. Taking granted that whatever we have in the nature is actually offering us weak damping, we can arrange these damping mediums to be more and more viscous. That is completely our choice. We can always go ahead with that. So this is what we see. The more resistive is the force, basically an oscillator has to lose its almost 63% of its initial energy. So we say that we pose it as a question, then how can I have an oscillating system actually? The answer is only in terms of damping, that if you can arrange a medium to be damping free, why not? You can. And then only you can have your oscillator to oscillate infinitely, otherwise it has to definitely die out. So, yeah, the oscillation has to die out. So this is the truth, that practically you don't have an ideal oscillator. So you can at the most can just ignore the air drag, but that is definitely going to just leave you with the natural frequency. But that's not the real situation. So how can we choose the best one out of all these damping oscillations? So the answer is given in terms of the quality factor. We have to always go and look at this value, that is basically the ratio of energy stored in an oscillator and what is that amount of energy that it is losing per cycle. So if we can reduce it, if we can reduce this amount of energy lost, we can always definitely have the oscillator which is going with oscillations infinitely. Otherwise, it has to definitely die out soon. So we measure that quality factor definitely in the lab. And the tool, as I mentioned earlier, again, is nothing but the pulse pendulum. What it does basically, it makes all these time oscillations to be on the recordable scale for us. So this pulse disk is a very nice arrangement connected with the forced oscillator also, that basically arranges all these time oscillations to be on the recordable side. And we can just keep record all these observations. So the what is the way these amplitudes are going on decaying with respect to time, that is basically a constant nature of the damping, as mentioned again. So this constant nature of the damping is interpreted and analyzed here in the form of another title name, that is basically logarithmic decrement. If we see, if we just use this exact solution, what we get from our damping solution of the equation of motion. So we see that these dying amplitudes are nothing but the function of a damping characteristics of the medium, that is b by 2m. So this constant ratio of the logarithm of the amplitude that was earlier to the amplitude that is basically going to be next stage is nothing but the logarithmic decrement, and that is when we conclude about the damping, because we can very easily measure it in the lab. So can we arrange now an oscillator to oscillate infinitely? The answer is definitely yes, we can do that. For that, we need to have our system to be forced. Now the whole situation is going to depend on three major parameters. One is the system that is forcing. We call that many a times as a driver. And another one is the system that is being forced. So we call that as a driven. And third one is nothing but the medium that is going to play its role by offering a constant resistance to all this. And that is basically the medium which is damping. So three things are now going to overlap with each other. So we see that this force, what we are going to apply, has to be a higher harmonic force, because we would not expect our force to again go naturally, although this is happening in nature. But we expect that force to go harmonically present here each time. Why each time? Because for a damping system, as we have seen earlier, many a time situations will happen where, each time when an oscillator is going to lose its energy, so the forcing system has to compensate that amount of lost energy. There is a natural struggle between what was the phase of this amount of increment in the force and what was that instantaneous phase of oscillator that can go opposite to each other. We'll see it. But if it is the two are in phase with each other, so this amount of energy will be compensated. So we see the complete solution here that is now going to form the two major parts. One is the natural damping affected, and another one is the forced. So this is the complete solution of a forced oscillation. We see that first part is nothing but the damping part. And the second part is nothing but the harmonically available as a compensation for the compensation of energy. So again, it is going to offer us to discuss the state of an oscillator for three different cases where what is happening, the frequency of the driver either is very low compared to the system what has been driven, either comparable to the frequency of the system what has been driven, or very high compared to the system what has been driven. So for all these three cases, we see what can happen with the forced oscillator. So first one is a very general case when the frequency of a driven system is sufficiently high compared to the frequency of a driver. So, it is very easy to expect that our system will keep on damping. So our system will keep on damping, so nothing is going to help it. But once we see that this is the, I'm just going to complete, reach that case. This is the situation here. So if we see that, we can see it is nothing but the same damping situation what is happening. So we can always have this driving force either falling in phase or falling out of phase. So or falling in the phase by 90. So all these situations we have two parameters, those are going to work. One is the amplitude resonance, another one is the velocity. So all these two specific quantities are very easily visible here. This is a problem in the sense that what is happening, as I mentioned earlier, that the moment this forcing system, the driver is going to feed the energy in a particular phase of cycle, maybe at that point of time, the driven system is going to lose its energy. So that is the condition out of phase, basically. So then we have this phase two, where this frequency of the driver is very high compared to the system what has been driven. This is the case when by default, what is happening that driver is going to take over. And it is almost impossible to record the natural state of the vibration of the material. Likewise, this is the critical damping that is going to give us the specific cases when can we have the amplitude resonance and when can we have the velocity resonance. So these specific cases are discussed and are compared with the mechanical analog. So this is how we can plot that what can be done by the damping. If we keep on increasing the damping, what is going to happen with X versus omega, you can see here. The amplitude will keep on decreasing. And what is going to happen with the velocity, you see here again. So this is how what is happening once you have a system that is going to have a specific omega naught, means the role of the natural frequency and the specific frequency, the new frequency that is basically comprising the combined effect of damping and the natural frequency. So one is going to affect the amplitude for the amplitude resonance. Another one is going to affect the velocity in the form of the velocity resonance. So the two can be segregated specifically in the frequency domain if we study all this specifically, like critical damping, weak damping, and forced damping. So this Paul's pendulum is a very nice setup that can provide us the opportunity to experience it practically in the lab. So again, the second order homogeneous differential equations, we can see it is again here. So it has now been shown in the form of the angular displacement, the way earlier we were showing in the form of the linear displacement. That does not make any difference because the experiment demands now the angular displacement to be recorded. So this is what the tables are, trial 1, trial 2, trial 3, say maximum amplitude 20 degrees. So each time it is going to be a new value that we keep recording, and we calculate the logarithmic decrement as a ratio of the amplitudes. And then we calculate the effect of damping. So in real life, we have all these RC circuits as a natural damping circuit, which cannot offer us the propagating electric field and the current maintaining the same value for all times. These are all resistive and damping circuits. And also in case of the real materials, as I mentioned earlier, so we have already used this word capacitor. So capacitor means nothing but the electric materials we have. So microscopically, how it is atomically rather, I would say how it is happening in case of a material. So a dielectric material is nothing but a material that can offer you the net electric dipole moment present. And on this basis, it is worth saying that every material is definitely a dielectric material, because you can always have this positive charge center of a nucleus and separated by some margin with the negative charge cloud there. So this is worth saying that every material has to be surely a dielectric material. So this theory is being described in the form of an again oscillating property of a dipole starting from electron proton combination to a microscopic ions level, where what we study in case of solid material. So now I would like to take your thinking that how damping is going to basically affect your measurements. So this oscillating nature is the virtue of every material part. You talk about an electron, you talk about an isolated ion, every object will have certain frequency of oscillation. So now it depends on the measurement domain where you are basically measuring, that are your measurements going to be precise or not. So it is always a struggle between the bulk versus thin film dielectrics. So how it is happening that for all measurements you will definitely have an electrical circuit with you, and keeping an electrical circuit with you means you are definitely handling with a dielectric material. So it is worth to know that what is the geometry of the dielectric material with you, whether you have a bulk format or you have the thin film format, and you understand the atomic structure, the total three-dimensional structure of these formats. You have these stages. Bulk is nothing but a three-dimensional array of all coupled oscillators, like electric dipoles. Thin film, thick films are also there, and then ultra thin films are also there. So what is different basically, once you move from a bulk to thin film, the frequency response will keep segregated out. Means you will not need to bother about the response coming from ions and connected atoms. You will just need to bother about the oscillation response of an electron, of an atom. So your domain of measurement will be more focused now. See here, dielectric materials are known to basically respond corresponding to the geometry, as I mentioned in the previous slide, in a different domain of electromagnetic radiation. So low frequency radiation is basically meant for heavy units like atoms or unit cells coupled together with each other. So those all heavy bulky units are going to respond in this radio and microwave frequency range. The moment you go for thick films, this part of the ionic or dipolar will get segregated out. Now you will need to talk about the individual vibration of an atom connected with some neighboring electron or some neighboring other charge. And then again, you will need to talk about the oscillation of an electron connected with the connected in an atom with a proton. So basically, if you keep on decreasing the dimension of your dielectric material, the geometry, you are basically shifting from radio microwave to UV visage. So this is how it is happening. So this is important. Once you are exposing your material with a visible or UV radiation, so all measurements what you record on the bulk are basically irrelevant. They are inaccurate. You cannot depend on those measurements because you are not at all affecting those measurements. So this is how the situation is. Now, if you keep on shifting on the left-hand side of infrared actuation, for example, so still the measurements on the bulk materials will be inaccurate because you have not actuated what you wanted to basically. So again, this once the stage comes for this radio and microwave actuation, this is what is going to call the call for the critical damping, where the frequency of the incident radiation is closely matching with the species present there. So this is what is going to offer you the critical damping, and then only you will have the amplitude response. So this is what you know. You want your you want your instrument to record the measurement, and in that pursuit, the measurement amplitude should be sufficiently high within the precision range of the equipment. So if you want your equipment to actually record the signal from the material, you should very well be aware that have you actuated your material in the right range. So this is the purpose of making yourself clear about that. For all electrical measurements, the critical damping is the requirement. This critical damping is the requirement if you actually want your equipment to record the correct observations. So again, what are the additional problems which you are going to interfere, which are going to basically encounter in these measurements? Once you have a dielectric material, so this dipole radiation is an obvious thing. You can understand that whenever a charged particle is oscillating, so it is basically accelerating, an accelerated charged particle has to radiate the energy. And radiation of energy means it is losing its energy, so damping is natural. So once you have a dielectric material in the EC field, so dipole radiation will create a natural damping present in the medium. and will make the electric fields what you are going to measure non-conservative. Because now magnetic field is there. Magnetic field is dynamically varying. So your field measurements will all be non-conservative, so be careful. So this is how again it is going to I'm going to summarize it. So whenever you have this data material subjected to an AC field, you have the competition between the dipole interference with the external. So be aware about it, that once you have this dipole part, so all those frequencies what you use for space charge and dipolar contributions are irrelevant for the dipole radiation. Means dipole radiation is weak enough at those frequencies. So all radio and microwave frequencies, the dipole radiation is not going to respond. But if you wish to measure a further higher range like terahertz radiation and UVBS radiation, your dipole radiation, you cannot neglect it. You cannot neglect it. So that is going to definitely interfere your readings. So